Thank you, Trent and Nathan, for leading us in worship. Thank you, Brandon, for moving this. This thing is heavy. If you've never moved it before, I really do appreciate it. I moved it this morning once, and I was like, definitely need some help doing that. Hey, if you're a kid in here, ages 4 through 2nd grade, I'm going to go ahead and let you be dismissed to Chapel Church. Go over here. Looks like the Hughes will be leading that, so head this way. You guys are dismissed. Run quickly. All right. So this morning, it's a pleasure to be filling the pulpit while Glenn and Jerry are in Israel. I'm excited for them to be there. And while they're there and we're here, we're going to be spending a couple weeks in the Old Testament. We're actually going to be looking at some famous passages, famous stories that you've heard since childhood. Actually, stories that really, in the church, I think sometimes we do an injustice to because we leave them in the children's ministry. We teach them there, and then we move past those things. And so this morning, as you can see on the screens, we're going to be talking about Noah and the Ark from Genesis 6. So if you have a Bible, go ahead and flip to Genesis chapter 6. That's where we're going to be this morning. Now, one of the reasons I decided to pick this passage is because I read and reread the story of Noah and the Ark on a very regular basis. Some of you might remember a few years ago, some of the ladies of the church threw a shower for Katie when she was pregnant with Noah, our Noah, and they were really awesome and creative, and instead of doing cards, they decided that everyone would bring books and sign books. And so I did a count this week. We have lots of books, by the way. I think we've probably bought 6 books in the past 2.5 years because we got so many from the shower. But here's the deal. I did a count this week of how many retellings of the story of Noah that we own. We own 5. So I read it and reread this probably every other week. And that got me thinking, we just don't teach it very often to adults. You don't go through it in Sunday school often, would be my guess. And so I thought, hey, why don't we re-look at and relearn some of the awesome truths from Noah and the Ark? Because here's the reality. Noah and the Ark, the story of Noah and the Ark is a collision of deep pain. It is. And an amazing grace. It is a cataclysmic story. It weaves together so many incredible themes. Themes like sin, themes like wickedness, things like righteousness and faith, covenant, judgment. All these themes run through the story of Noah and the Ark. It's amazing. Now, we can't cover all of those themes in one sermon. We would be here for about 6 or 7 hours, so I'm not going to do that to you guys this morning. This morning, my goal is this. I want us to re-look at the story. I want us to sit under the story and to let the truths that come to the surface press us deeper in to a love for Christ. You know, sometimes when I read stories in the Old Testament, I try to read them this way. I try to read them as if it was my grandfather sitting in a rocking chair telling me stories. Just gaining wisdom, just hearing truths that can shape my thinking and my living and my feeling. And that's my hope for this morning, is that Noah and the Ark, this story you've all heard probably over 12 times, can touch your heart again and press you into a deeper love for Christ. So with that in mind, let's pray to God and let's ask Him to do what only He can do to help us to change our hearts. Father, we come to you this morning just in awe of who you are. God, you are worthy. As we sang, God, you are due the glory. You're due the honor. You are excellent. You are above our words. No pen or penner could write how amazing you are. Lord, I ask this morning that you would make Jesus beautiful. God, that you would shine through this story, that you would teach us, that you would press us into you. God, we need you. And your word is good and we trust it. And so we ask you to move this morning. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. All right, we're in Genesis chapter 6, verses 5 and through 7. Okay, so here we go. It says this. It says, "The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord regretted that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So the Lord said, I will blot out man, whom I have created from the face of the land, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens, for I am sorry that I have made them." This is the backdrop. It's the context to the story of Noah and the ark. And I want you to understand the picture Moses, the author of Genesis, paints for us is this. It's a perverse culture. The universality of sin is incredibly pervasive. The way I see it is, if I put a cup of water here on this podium, put a cup of water here on the pulpit, you could see right through it, and I took a bottle of black dye and I just poured it in there. Think about how the black dye would permeate through the water. Ultimately, you wouldn't be able to see through the glass water. And the glass of water. And I think that's what's happening in this culture. It's like Gotham City minus organized crime. It's horrible. It's a terrible culture. The wickedness is pervasive. You know, I don't think our culture is all that different. In fact, I think it's exactly identical. I don't think culture has changed really all that much. I heard a story last week about an 8-year-old who killed their younger sister. Mom was gone at work, and the 8-year-old was upset because the 1-year-old would not stop crying. And so the 8-year-old made the 1-year-old stop crying. And, you know, that brings in all sorts of questions. All sorts of questions about who's at fault, what happened, who's the murderer, who's the one who committed manslaughter. Is the mom at fault? Is the son at fault? Ultimately, I think what it pictures is this. We're sinful. From birth, we're sinful. We're bent towards sin. Wickedness is all around us, and it's in our heart. That's what verse 5 says. It says, "The Lord saw the wickedness of man. It was great in the earth, and it like a drumbeat." I hear this like a drumbeat. "And that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." That's how God evaluated that culture, the culture Noah lived in. And his evaluation led God to a broken heart. God was brokenhearted. In fact, he was so grieved that he was sorry that he had even created man. Now, let me be clear. This is important for us to understand. God wasn't sorry in that he made man. He wasn't sorry for making man. But he was sorry that his good creation had now become so twisted and so broken, so different than his original design and purpose. See, remember in Genesis 1:31, after God created, students in T2, you know this verse, after God created, he stepped back and he looked across everything and he said it was what? Very good. His creation was good. But then Adam and Eve rebel against God, sin enters the world, death enters the world, the first murder in the first family. And then you have the angels leaving their proper dwelling, sleeping with women and having babies. And God declares every person evil continually, the thoughts of their heart. And so God is grieved, and he's going to respond. That's what verse 7 tells us. So the Lord said in Genesis chapter 6, verse 7, it says, "I will blot out man, whom I have created from the face of the land, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens, for I'm sorry that I have made them." God is going to destroy the world Noah knows. He's going to destroy the world of Noah. His righteous judgment will fall. No pun intended, right? It will fall. It's coming upon the entire world. And that's when the unique man, Noah, enters the scene. In Genesis 6, verse 9, Noah enters the scene, and here's what Genesis 6, 9 tells us. It tells us that Noah was blameless and righteous in his generation. It tells us that Noah loved God. He walked with God. He had intimacy with God. He stood apart from his culture. He was like a bright light in the darkness, right? You've gone into your bathroom before in the middle of the night, and if you messed up and flipped on the switch, you understand what a bright light does to people living in darkness. That's how Noah was. He was a bright light in a dark, dark culture. The Bible tells us in Genesis 6:8 that God decides to show favor to Noah. He bestows grace upon Noah, and he chooses Noah for an incredible task, the task of continuing the line of humanity. Right? That was Noah's true task, to continue the human race. Noah is chosen for this task. God tells him to build an ark, right? A very large boat. Build an ark and fill it with two of every animal. You probably don't know this. Maybe you do if you've read it closely. He also tells Noah to put seven of every clean animal on the ark as well. It's in Genesis chapter 7. Read it. Okay. But he says, put two of every animal on the ark and also your family. Take your family along as well. I love this. Genesis chapter 6, the end of the chapter, is really important for us to get because it teaches us that even in the midst of God's judgment that's coming to the world, even in the midst of that, God has a plan, right? Even in the midst of that, grace is in operation, and that he has a desire for mankind, that he loves mankind, and he wants to do something in this world. And so, Noah goes to work. Right, if you've ever read a storybook Bible, okay, you've probably seen this scene. In my storybook Bible that we read at the breakfast table, this scene has Noah with like this scroll. Okay, and on this scroll, Noah's working on the ark. On this scroll is like this blueprint. You see the ark, it's like designed out for him. And then it has like these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 steps. And you can see that Noah has scribbled through a couple of them because he's already completed a few. But then in the background, there's like this pile of wood that's been cut. And there's this saw, a two-handed saw, that's laying against this pile of wood, as if Noah and maybe one of his sons, Japheth or Shem, are using the saw together to cut the wood. And I love that picture because if I was anything like Noah, man, I would need it all, right? I'm not a skilled woodworker. I'm guessing Noah wasn't either. Right? He needed the blueprints. He needed the designs. And we see that God gave him very clear instructions in Genesis 6 on how to build the ark. But one of the things I take from that is this. When God calls us to a task, hear this. When God calls you to a task, he will equip you for it. He will. Whatever that task may be, God will equip you for that task. So if it's to share the gospel with your kids, if it's to share the gospel with a friend, if it's to love on someone you're having a hard time loving, or forgive someone you're having a hard time forgiving, God either has or will equip you for that task. Never forget that. And so Noah builds, and he builds, and he builds, during which time, if you have a storybook Bible, you know that everyone and their donkey comes out and makes fun of Noah. Right? Isn't that the case? Everyone comes out and they point and they mock him. They make fun of him. They laugh at him. They call him names. Right? Christians would call that persecution. They persecute him. Now, it's not in the actual Bible. We don't have that recorded. But I think it's easy to understand that the culture would do that. I mean, first off, Noah is so different than everyone else. He's the only one blameless and righteous in his generation. So he's already different. He's already unique. But secondly, some people say that it had never rained before the flood. That's what we read in Genesis 2, 5 and 6. Some people read this and they say the first rain was actually the flood. In Genesis 2, 5 and 6, it reads this. When no bush of the field was yet in the land, and no small plant of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the land, and there was no man to work the ground. A mist was going up from the land and was watering the whole face of the ground. And so some people take that verse and they say, look, before the flood, the earth was watered by a heavy dew that would come up at night. And so it was crazy that Noah was even saying a flood was going to come, that it was actually going to rain. I don't know if that is indefensible, but maybe. But I think finally Noah was building a boat, an ark, in the middle of the desert. Right? That's enough to make anyone, including a good Christian at First Baptist Church, point and laugh. It is. It's enough to make anyone point and laugh. And so Noah faced persecution as he built the ark. But I love what Genesis 6:22 tells us. It says this: Noah did this. That means Noah built the ark. It means Noah regarded God. He didn't have regard for man. Noah did this. He did all that God had commanded him. I think that's an amazing summary of Noah. And so the ark is built, and God tells Noah to get on in with him and with his family and the animals. Get in the ark. And then the Lord shuts him in. Okay, that's an important part of the story. The Lord shuts the ark. Here's where we see God's protection, divine protection. Now we have to understand, if Noah didn't physically walk up the ramp into the boat, then God would have destroyed him in the flood. It would have happened. God would have sent the flood on Noah and destroyed. Noah had to physically move his legs up the ramp. He had to do that. He had to. But God had to shut the door. It's divine protection. The Lord taking care of and securing us, right? That door shut has implications for you and me. It's why we're alive, right? The door stays open. There is no First Baptist Church, and there is no continuation of the human line. Everyone perishes. And so God takes care of it, and the rain begins to fall. 40 days, 40 nights. Here's what my storybook Bible says. And we read this probably 4 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago in the storybook Bible. It says this: and it started raining for minutes that joined up into hours, that joined up into days, that joined up into weeks and weeks. And the rain joined up into puddles, that joined up into rivers, that joined up into lakes, that joined up into a flood that covered the whole world. This is not a children's story, church. It's just not. It's good for children to learn. There's a lot of cool elements that children love about it. But when I think about the fury of God flashing upon this earth, especially in the form of a flood, it's terrifying. The heavens were opened, the depths were broken, and I can see this in the eye of my mind. Men and women walking through a town ankle deep in water, and then waist deep in water, and then swimming, and then getting exhausted and drowning, right? Mothers treading water with their babies held above their heads. This is what happened. People fighting to stay in the top branches of the trees. This is the judgment of God that fell that day in those days of Noah. For 40 days and 40 nights, the Bible tells us the waters prevailed so mightily that even the tops of the mountains were covered. Right? Everyone died. Worldwide flood. Noah and his family preserved in the ark. And this is the result of God's action. Genesis 7:21 says this: and all flesh died that moved on the earth. Birds, livestock, beasts, all swarming creatures that swarm on the earth, and all mankind. Everyone and everything perished, right? God's judgment fell. It accomplished its purpose. But God did not leave Noah on the boat. I want you to understand that. God remembered Noah. God remembered his promise to Noah. And he sends a wind that blows upon the waters. And the waters begin to dry. Noah was on the ark for 370 days. It's a long time on a boat with a lot of animals and just your intimate family. It's a long time, okay? It's like Christmas for 370 days, okay? Which is beautiful in some ways. But the land dries, and there's this series of Noah sending out birds, first a raven, then the dove again, and then finally the dove goes and doesn't come back. Right, and so everyone leaves the ark. And in a good retelling of the story, if you have kids, you've seen this. Like, this part gets 2 pages, and I never got it until this week. Right, 2 pages in the middle of the book or near the end, you have all the animals coming off the ark. You've seen this in the book. Right, all the animals come off the ark. They're in this long line. You got the hippos and the kangaroos. You got the puppies, depending on who publishes it. And then you've got like the kittens and the giraffes, all that stuff. And then Noah's over here, and there's a fire, and he's looking up to heaven, and there's a clouds and with the sun and then the rainbow. It's really a Hallmark moment. And I always thought, what is going on with this? Like, why is this so crucial? Like, why does this get so much attention? There's so many other cool details in the story. And I realized this week, that was the moment that Noah realized his salvation. Because up until that point, he was relying on God's word. It was still faith until the door opened and he walked out on land. It was his realization of his physical salvation. And truly, when artists draw that picture in the storybook Bible, I hope they're thinking, that was the realization of our physical salvation. We wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for that scene. And I think the only thing that we can compare to that today is our spiritual salvation. The moment when we trust in Jesus Christ and our sin is gone, our shame is gone, our sin is forgiven, our shame is gone, we're reconciled to God by Christ. It's a beautiful picture. And so Noah comes off the ark, his family comes off, the animals come off, right? But Noah does something. In Genesis 8:20, this is what we read. It says, Noah built an altar to the Lord, and he took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. This is why he brought so many pairs of animals, not just a pair. He brought 7 pairs. Noah was praising and thanking God. He was praising God because God was good on his word. Remember, God warned him that the flood would come, and Noah in faith built the ark. He built it before the flood. Like, it wasn't raining while he was building. He had to trust God on his word. And when he came off, he praised God for his mighty salvation. It was his response to God. And then God makes a promise in Genesis 9, verses 11 through 13. Very famous promise to Noah and to us. It says this. This is God speaking. I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, this is the sign of the covenant, or the promise that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the cloud, that is the rainbow, and it shall be a sign of the promise between me and the earth. And so God promises never again to flood the earth, to destroy the earth by flood. He promises Noah, and because this is an eternal covenant, an eternal promise, he promises his future generations, which is us. He promises us. And he gave us a sign to remember. A sign's the rainbow. We know this. But you know, I used to think that I thought the rainbow was such a kind of a dainty and weak symbol. Like, okay, so the rainbow, it's just kind of weak. It's kind of dainty. And part of that is probably because the LGBT community hijacked it and uses it as a promo tool for their movement. But something about it, right? You see a rainbow painted, and there's usually like some sort of leprechaun that has rosy red cheeks. I don't know. I just thought it was a weak symbol until I read this. I read this in my storybook Bible. It's a really good Bible for kids, for children. It says this, "And like a warrior who puts away his bow and arrow at the end of a great battle, God said, 'See, I have hung up my bow, Noah, in the clouds.' The rainbow isn't dainty. It's not weak. In fact, when we look at the rainbow, we should see wrath and mercy. We should see toughness and tenderness, judgment and grace. The rainbow is strong. It's a strong symbol. And it's a symbol that should remind us of the grace and mercy, but also the righteousness of God." That's the famous story of Noah and the Ark. There's other things that we could draw out from the story. There's many things. I worked really hard not to spend 3 hours just on the story. But that's the story. That's what happened. Those are the main things that took place. But in the New Testament, we get to see God's verdict, his commentary on the life of Noah. We get to see what God says about who Noah was and what he did. See, because we want to draw some conclusions from this story, some truths that can impact us today, that can change our thinking and press us into Christ. But first, I think we need to see the conclusion God draws. And we find that in Hebrews 11:7. The author of Hebrews was kind enough to write down one verse for us about Noah and the summation of the Noah and the ark. Here's what it says in Hebrews 11:7. It says this, "By faith Noah, being warned by God concerning events as yet unseen, in reverent fear constructed an ark for the saving of his household. By this he condemned the world and became an heir of righteousness that comes by faith." You know, when I think of the life of Noah, and I think of the commentary here in Hebrews 11, the centerpiece of Noah's life was this. When Noah was warned by God of something that was not yet seen, right? Something in the future. That's the flood. When Noah was warned by God about the flood that was going to come, Noah responded obediently. He began to make practical preparations in that he built the ark before the flood came, because he knew God's word would come true. And so when we think about the centerpiece of Noah's life, the centerpiece of the story, it's this. Noah took God at his word. Simple. Noah took God at his word. Noah lived a life that took God at his word. Hebrews 11:7 told us that he was warned about something yet unseen, yet seen, and he decided to construct an ark for the saving of his household. That's faith. Trent talked about it this morning. To believe isn't just to mentally ascend to a truth. It's not just to know something. It's to know something that forces your hand, that causes you to move. And for Noah, it was to build an ark. And he built it in reverent fear. That's how the ESV translates that. That's amazement. That's awe. He built it in amazement. Why? I think because he was thankful that God had chosen him for such a task. God didn't have to choose Noah. He didn't. He could have done it another way, but he did. And Noah built the ark with reverent fear, taking God at his word. Now, I've been a parent for 2.5 years. okay, maybe a little longer than that, not much. And in my expert opinion, I've come to some pretty amazing conclusions. Like, here's one thing that I found. Sometimes when you parent and you're trying to do good things for your kids, they get really upset about it. Like, they throw big time tantrums. Like, for instance, you may brush their teeth, and your kids just, they don't like it. And they're going to scream and cry about it. Like, you're trying to be good, trying to be sweet. Like, hey, I want to, you know, dental hygiene, it's a good thing. I'm going to brush your teeth, and they just squall about it. Or maybe it's like you're going to change their diaper. You're like, I don't want you sitting in your pee, son. I'm going to change your diaper. And they get upset about it, right? They throw a fit. Sometimes it's, I don't want you walking with the pencil because you may jab your eye out. So you take the pencil and they get mad. Like, I've seen some of these things at play. But I've also found that there's some things that are generally more true. Like, for instance, with Emma Kate. When Emma Kate starts crying and she starts kind of getting in her mood, throwing a little tantrum, I found that there's some specific things that if I do them, it 95% of the time gives me the result of her not crying anymore. Right? 95% of the time. Okay, she starts screaming, okay, I'll give her her passy. If that doesn't work, then okay, so maybe she just wants to be held. If that doesn't work, and she's like, I don't want to be held, maybe her lovey. If she has her lovey, she can snuggle it, she'll be happy. If that doesn't work, bottle, food. And sometimes you have to add them all together and make mommy do it, and then we can get the waterworks to turn off. But we understand these things. We understand that we can do certain things that give us the results we want, right? If you're a college student, okay, if you're a college student here, you know that if you do three things, you can make straight A's. Now, I don't care what you study, three things. Go to class, take good notes, and study. Like, getting a degree is, it doesn't take a super genius, right? You can get a degree. It's hard work. Going to class can be hard work. Taking good notes can be hard work. And then studying them, that's more hard work on top of it. But I'm convinced that if you do those three things, you can get an A in almost any class in college. Almost any. If you're a football player, here's what you know. If you study your plays, specifically your offensive plays, and you know them back and forth, you know them perfectly, when the play is called, you are free to thoughtlessly do anything you want. You know the play. And so you are dangerous because you're not thinking as you're moving, what do I do next? You know it. And so you're able to not only respond to what's happening, but to do more than you could. Right? You understand that as a football player or as a basketball player. As a husband, do you understand that if you plan, right, you plan your anniversary celebration early, that will result in a happy wife? Right? We understand these things. There are certain things in life that we know if we do certain things, good results will happen. And for Noah, because he was a man that took God at his word, he got two results according to this passage. And here, let's look back at the passage, the second half of it, Hebrews 11:7. It says this, the second half. Can we move to that second half? By this, Noah condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. Now that this here is faith. By faith, Noah condemned the world. That's the first thing. It's the first thing that resulted from Noah taking God at his word, being a man of faith. What does it mean that Noah condemned the world? I think that's a good question. What does that even mean? Well, it means this. His righteous obedience to God was so sharp compared to the culture, that it painted how sinful and wicked the culture truly was. And we've seen this at play in our life. If you're a Christian in here, if you're not, you know when you've done something wrong, or you're just not walking with God. You know when you're not close to Him, your heart's kind of hard, maybe you're struggling with a secret sin, whatever it may be. And then you have a friend in your life, and that friend is walking with God, and they're loving God, and they know Him, and they're doing great things for the Lord, and they enter into your life on occasion, and they just tell you about those things. In your heart, you feel that conviction if you're a Christian. Right? If you're not a Christian, in your heart, you feel that condemnation. And that's what was taking place in Noah's time. Noah was obedient to God, and so he built the boat. And the culture was condemned by Noah because Noah was saying this in his actions. I don't care what you guys think. I'm going to follow the Lord. Every nail and every piece of wood that I cut, and every time I ask my sons to heave up another piece of wood so I can put it together, I'm trusting the Lord. And that displayed his condemnation to the world. It showed that he regarded God over the world, that he disapproved of what the world was doing at that time. But then secondly, and maybe more importantly, by faith, Noah became an heir of righteousness. Just one verse earlier in Hebrews, it tells us that it is impossible to please God without faith. I hope you understand that. It is impossible to please God without faith. You can do a million good things, but if you don't have faith in Jesus Christ, those things are nothing but rebellion. In your own power and your own strength, a good deed outside of Jesus Christ it's a bomb set off against the Lord. It's a cry of, I am strong enough, I am good enough. I don't need help, and I don't need surrender. But see, Noah became an heir of righteousness by faith. An heir of righteousness. He took God at his word, and it led to him becoming righteous. See, it led to his physical salvation. But we know Noah took God at his word because he walked with God, which meant he had faith in God, which meant that he was righteous, spiritually speaking. And so when we think about the life of Noah and the story of Noah and the ark, the summit, the centerpiece, the banner, the waves over his life is that he was a man who took God at his word. And so I think the final question is this: what does this mean to you and me? What does that mean to First Baptist Church, 21st century, 2015, November 15th? What does that mean to us? Yeah, Noah was a great guy. He loved God. He took him at his word. Cool. I think it means this: Noah is someone we should copy, someone we should mimic. And he wasn't perfect. He was an imperfect model, but he was someone that we should copy. See, some people think the Bible is full of heroes. Like, you look at the Bible, and it's just chocked full of heroes. And it's true, there are heroes in the Bible. I think Noah is one of them. But I think what we should always remember, and I get this from maybe from Carl, I'm not sure. But I think one of the things we should always remember is this. Poison sang in 88. They wrote a song. And part of the lyrics say this: every rose has its thorn, and every cowboy sings his sad, sad song. And that's true of any man and any woman in the Bible. They have their thorns. They have their warts. They have their sad songs that they sing. See, Noah, the last pictures we get of his life is this. He comes off the ark. He begins to be a worker of the field. He plants a vineyard. And he takes those grapes and he makes them into wine and he gets drunk. Paul would tell us centuries later, do not be filled. Do not be filled with the wine, but rather be filled with the Holy Spirit. But see, Noah gets drunk. And he's naked in his tent. And his youngest son, Ham, comes into the tent. And he sees his nakedness. Here's the problem with that. In that time, in that culture, that was a grave dishonor to a father. bad mistake, right? Hand in the cookie jar. Noah wakes up, hears what his son has done, and curses his grandson, Canaan, and his future generations. See, Noah's sin, getting drunk with wine, led to the cursing of Canaan. By the way, Joshua went into the land of Canaan to take the land from Noah's grandson and those generations. Right? He curses them. Noah was an imperfect model. But I think three things that we take away from his life. This. First thing is that we should walk with God. So simple. We need to walk with God. Noah walked with God. Genesis 6:9 tells us that he walked with the Lord. He had an intimate relationship with him. He knew God. John Calvin, in his commentary on Genesis, says this. He says, what it means to walk with God is that it means to have a regard for God above everything else. Think about it. Noah was kind of like a Lone Ranger Christian. He had his family. That's it. That's all he had. He didn't have this. He didn't have a group of people like this to walk with him and to keep him accountable. And so he walked with the Lord. I'm sure there were some lonely times. I mean, he was the head of that family, and he had to make some tough decisions. And so he walked with God. He regarded God above others. And my question for you is, are you walking with God? Are you looking at this book? If you want to walk with God, you have to open this thing. You got to look at it. You got to seek him. You can't seek someone you don't know. You can't seek someone you don't spend time with. Are you walking with God? Is he shaping the way you treat your family? Is he shaping the way you pursue your studies? Is he shaping the way you handle your money? Is he shaping the way you work? The way you talk at the water cooler? Is he shaping those things? Is he shaping the way you use social media, students? Right? Is he shaping the way you think? Or is our culture shaping the way you think? I think the second thing we learn is that we are to take God at his word. It's pretty simple. I think that's a great statement of faith. What is faith? Taking God at his word. Trusting his word. Believing it. Take him at his word and walk it out. See, Noah had a settled confidence in God. He was settled. He made a decision. He believed. He was confident that God would come through on his word. And so he built the ark. He came through. God came through. Remember, he flooded the world. And I want you to understand, the flood did not solve any sin issue. I hope you notice that. Romans 3 tells us that everyone sinned, all fall short of the glory of God, right? It tells us no one seeks God, no one understands God, right? The flood didn't solve the sin issue, right? It was his exact judgment, his righteous judgment upon the world. But it gives us a picture that there is another flood coming. This isn't a literal flood. See the rainbow. But there is another flood coming, a flood of God's judgment, that he will judge everyone based upon what they do. And I commend you today to take God at his word. In John 14:6, we read that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, that no one comes into the Father but through him. If you want to know God the Father, you have to go through Jesus Christ. You have to trust him. See, I would say that Jesus Christ is our ark today. The ark that we need to run to. The ark that we need to hide in against the flood of judgment that will come. And I wonder this morning if you're in the ark of Jesus Christ. Have you trusted in Christ? And if you have, are you daily taking God at his word? Do you believe that having integrity in your job is better than trying to get a foot up? Do you believe that doing the right thing that God calls you to, that brings glory to him, is better than taking a shortcut. Do you believe those things? Flood's coming. There's only one ark. It's Jesus Christ. Take him at his word and find joy in that. And then finally, I think the story of Noah teaches us to be encouraged so that we can persevere. I think for the Christian, the story of Noah and the ark serves as a beacon of hope. See, Noah lived in a culture that was wicked. It was a horrible culture. And I think we can understand that. I think we can relate to that. If you watch the news, if you're aware of what's going on in our world, there are things every day that picture how terrible of a world we are. Much of it coming in the name of equality, in the name of equal rights. We live in a culture similar to Noah, in a wicked and pervasive culture. But see, the story of Noah and the ark should encourage us that even in the midst of something like that, if we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, then we are operating in a domain of grace. That means we can have hope. That means we can go through hard things and we can see difficult things like Paris, and we can rise up for the good, and we can rise up for God's glory, and we can rise up for our love of God and our love of neighbor to do the right thing, to help, to serve, to pray. And we can do that knowing that we are safe, finally and ultimately, because of Christ. And we may lose our life, and we may suffer persecution like Noah did. But if we take God at his word and we persevere in it, we will be there when God rights wrongs. And we will be there when he makes all the crooked lines straight. And my hope for our church is this. It's Hebrews 10:39. See, Hebrews chapter 11, it gives us what's popularly called the Hall of Faith, right? A bunch of men and women who came before us that we can look to as examples to follow, right? But Hebrews 10:39 is the verse before Hebrews 11 starts. And here's what it says. And this is my hope for our church. But we, First Baptist Church of Iowa Park, are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls. This morning, I hope you're encouraged by the story of Noah and the ark. I hope you see that he was a man who took God at his word. That we should be a church. We should be a people. You should be parents and grandparents, brothers and sisters, students, co-workers who take God at his word, who love him, who follow him, who stand against a mighty wave of a culture that do not love God. Does not love God and does not want you to love him either. Because I'm telling you, if you live a life of faith, banking on God, taking him at his word, the culture will feel condemned. It will. It'll feel condemned because you will stand in bright contrast. I read just this morning, that pregnancy help centers are 3-1 to abortion clinics. And it's got some people really upset. It does. That's that condemnation. They feel it. We do good. They feel condemned because they're not in Christ. So this morning, wherever you're at on the spectrum, whether you know Christ or not, I call you to respond to him. Maybe that means growing in your faith. Maybe that means laying down a sin. Maybe that means taking God at his word in a specific area that he's speaking to you about. If you're not a Christian in here, I just say run to Jesus. A flood's coming, a flood of judgment. It will come. You will stand before God. And if you're not in the ark that is Jesus Christ, if you've not trusted in him, that will not be a good day for you.